YouTube, Engineering is Magic, coming to you from the hospital. Time to make a little video just to relieve some people's nerves. I promised I would. And in this video, I want to talk about our place in the universe. Now, this is a complex question, you know, sometimes left to philosophers and stuff, but there really are some simple answers. And, you know, I'm just going to try to explain where I feel, you know, people fit in, you know, where me and you fit in. And, you know, so obviously the first thing that we both are is we're both humans, right? And this doesn't matter who I am and who you are. You know, we're all humans, right? And, you know, there's human fallacy. There's lots of stuff that goes on with humans. But I'm not going to get into, you know, a lot of human nature stuff right now, because it's important to, you know, back up even from human nature and figure out where we are. So as a human, what we are is a mammal. You know, we're nothing but mammals, so let's do it like they do on the Discovery Channel, right? You know? And so this is, you know, like a cat or a dog. You know, these are other mammals. You know, we all, you know, as mammals, we, you know, give live birth, have milk to feed our young, you know, and are warm-blooded, you know, to help regulate our metabolism. You know, and I mean, these groupings are specifically, you know, not complete. You know, there's lots of other things that are mammals, obviously, right? Like dolphins, you know, elephants, and all sorts of other animals. And this isn't meant to be complete, but this is meant to give you, you know, a reference point all the way back. And, you know, if you got a joint, light one now. I can't. I'm just on the percocet, so. But, yeah. So, you know, and what mammals are is just, you know, another part of animals, right? You know, there's lots of animals that aren't mammals, like reptiles, you know, birds, other things, you know, dinosaurs, other animals that have died before, right? And, you know, so animals, so now we're all the way back to, you know, all animals, right? So we're kind of like zooming out, we're bringing it out here. And, you know, animals are just another part of life, right? We're all alive. And, but you know, not all life is animals. We have plants, right? And plants are specifically animals, you know, or life, not animals, but life that can make its own food. You know, it's the part of life that has, you know, determined photosynthesis, basically, right? The ability to take power from the sun and, you know, turn it into food, you know, energy that it can use. And, you know, animals, by the other side, are things that eat basically plants to survive. You know, most food webs, you know, and food networks like that are based on the sun, you know, based on photosynthesis. But not all life is plants or animals. You know, single cellular life, you know, and lots of other life. And this is really where it gets interesting, you know, in terms of trying to organize humanity and all of this, you know, like organization of life. You know, this is like the taxonomy problem, right? Like, biologists love this problem of taxonomy, trying to organize life into certain ways that make sense, you know, to help us understand, you know, the groupings of how animals are the same and different. And basically, you know, when you group things together as similar, you know, you can rely on certain things that are similar about it, like mammals have warm blood. And, you know, based on those things that you have grouped in similarity, so now you can say, like, okay, I can make something that will apply to all mammals, or maybe just humans, or maybe just cats and dogs, or, you know, whatever. But, you know, as you pull back from this and get more general, you know, and further away from the specific, things get a little bit more abstract, right? And so what life is really, you know, this is the cell theory now, you know, life is a collection of cells usually, right? It's pretty much, you know, and this gets into, you know, like if viruses are alive and stuff, because viruses don't have cells, you know, they attach to cells and use cells. But really, you know, cells are kind of like the building blocks, the Legos of life. And, you know, sometimes we think of things in cells, sometimes we think of things in you know, people or humanity or organs, you know, which are kind of groups of cells, right? You know, there's all sorts of different ways to group cells into more complex ways, right? And, you know, the complex groupings of multiple cells is really what life is. You know, the brain is a combination of cells. Your liver is a combination of cells. you know, everything, your skin is a combination of cells, and they've all decided to do something specific to let you be you. And it's this combination of millions and billions of these cells, you know, and it's so big that we have hard times, you know, looking at it in whole, right? You know, nobody thinks about things in terms of individual cells anymore, maybe unless you're, you know, unless you have cancer or something like that, you know, where individual cells are really important. But, you know, usually we think of things in organs. We think of things in behaviors. And this is really, you know, human consciousness coming into play. Just because, you know, just because it's real doesn't mean that we have the ability to understand it. You know, and so we come up with ways to try to understand it. I think that is what our nature is. You know, and of course I'll get into more of that in the human nature. This is more like the background, you know, and the connections of everything, right? So, and now let's keep breaking it down here. So I'm going to turn the page, and so we will start off with cells here, and because this is going to get really complicated, right? And so cells are made up of, you know, molecules known as lipids. You know, this is like one of the things, like, so cells on their outside are, you know, covered in lipids, which are kind of like fat-like molecules, you know, polar molecules that make up the walls of cells, you know, the border around the cell that lets certain things through. And then, you know, you also have stuff like DNA, right? And this is like the encoding mechanism for, you know, all of the knowledge inside of the cell. And these things are huge, you know, and we think about them and all the time, right? And each cell has its own copy of this, and sometimes multiple copies, you know, and that's really, and all cells have this, not just human cells, all cells. And it's important that we realize these similarities, right? And so, you know, what else is in cells? You know, you have kind of like non-biological molecules, you have ions, you know, like sodium and potassium. Sorry, I got those out of order. And, you know, like different ions that the cell needs. Basically, you know, a cell is kind of like its own, it's its own thing where it can survive sometimes by itself. You know, usually it relies on other cells in a more complex being to provide food. You know, red blood cells don't have the ability to oxygenate themselves. They go to lung cells and capillaries for that. But let's not get into too much of that complexity right there. So, but really, all of these things are molecules. You know, they're complex, you know, like sugar, C6H12O6, is a molecule. ATP is a molecule. This is what, you know, is the basis of respiration in the human cell and the mitochondria that gives us our ability to take energy, you know, from other sources like plants and other animals and convert it so that we can survive as fuel for our cells. And, you know, I'm not going to say that it's good or bad. You know, I think judging things like this is always dangerous. And I'll talk about, you know, judging things. And that's bringing that human component into it again, right? It's very easy to confuse yourself if you, you know, think of everything as like you. Not everything is like you. We are like, we, you know, humans are alike, but not everything is human. But yet we try to anthropomorphize a lot of things and make them like us because it's more convenient. But really, we need to understand the breadth and, you know, knowledge and the, you know, just the hugeness of everything, right? So molecules, and, you know, we're already getting into really tight scientific country, you know, so this is kind of like the study of biology usually. You know, they talk about pathways, which are different patterns that molecules undergo in the cell, like the respiration pathway, the citric acid pathway. You know, all sorts of different things that normally happen in the cell. And, you know, biologists usually look at molecules for this, right? And, like, other parts of the cell. But really, what are molecules made out of? You know, and I've kind of hinted at it here with this chemical formula, but molecules are made out of atoms, right? Sorry. And that was a really sloppy percocet circle there. But, you know, and atoms are basically, you know, one of these more fundamental building blocks. And an atom is a protons, neutrons, and electrons. This is the combination. And all atoms are made of these three major parts. So a proton is like a positively charged particle. You know, they call them particles. It's hard to come up with names that for something so generic. You know, a neutron is a neutral particle. It has no charge, but it has mass. And an electron has negative charge, and it has a very small mass. So once you get down to this, you know, like really nobody looks at a human in terms of how many protons, neutrons, and electrons they are. It just doesn't make sense. It doesn't help us to understand things. But yet, you know, all of this, you know, this kind of area is physics, right? Physics. Physics defines, you know, well, it's actually chemistry too, right? So chemistry is kind of at this border here. So chemistry is how molecules and atoms interact with each other to make compounds, to do things, to form things. But at the chemistry level, you know, you do have like biological chemistry, which you focus on, you know, molecules that are in a biological system. But really, when you get down to chemistry, it's not really alive or unalive at that point. You know, chemical reactions happen all the time. And most of the chemical reactions that happen in cells happen normally. We make them faster with catalysts and enzymes and such. And then, you know, atoms themselves are not really alive, right? Like, they can make up living things, but we exchange atoms all the time. Every time you breathe in and out, you are expelling, you know, huge numbers of carbon dioxide molecules, and you're pulling in oxygen molecules, and your body is doing all these amazing things with them, right? But really what, you know, underlies this all is physics. And so now, if you want to go like one level under here, now you're kind of into quantum theory, right? You know, like what makes up an electron? What makes up a neutron? What makes up a proton? You know, and you have like quarks and all this other stuff. And this is really, you know, complicated. And it's so complicated that, you know, we typically try to ignore it if we can. And we can only look at it in terms of really small scale. And, you know, we never look at terms of a human in terms of quantum, you know, physics. Although now we're kind of trying to, you know, think about the brain as a quantum machine and all this other stuff. But really, it's really hard because there's just so much stuff to keep track of that it's not really easy to do that. You know, all the computing power in the world wouldn't probably be able to keep track of such things. You know, particle accelerators, when they do these experiments, they're taking, you know, small numbers of atoms, you know, in the tens or dozens of atoms and doing, you know, atom smashing experiments with them, but they keep it low to keep it simple, right? You know? And we're still at that simple point in physics and quantum physics like that. So, why did I do this and why did I tell us this? Well, maybe, okay, there's one more thing that we should get into, and that is energy, right? Energy. You know, everybody knows E equals mc squared, right? Now, take a hit and tell me what you think that means. I'll wait. Okay, what this means is that the rest mass of atoms, you know, anything with mass, is equivalent to energy, you know, by some constant, you know, which is the speed of light squared. So really, what everything is, at some fundamental level, is energy. Atoms, matter, you know, like this table that I'm writing on right here, it is energy. And the molecules that have condensed, you know, kind of like become, you know, part of physical reality here, you know, they have energy, but their energy is bound up in matter. And then sometimes, you know, you have temperature, which is like the energy kind of like left over, you know, that it still exists in a more energetic state, you know, which can be transferred back and forth. You get into things like conductivity and insulation. But you know, really, it's just amazing. When you get all down to it, here we are. And, you know, we're all life. And life is just this incredibly complex thing. And, you know, if you talk to a creationist about how life, you know, formed in 747, 800, that, you know, gets put together by itself, really, creationists don't even understand or contemplate how complicated it is. And I'm not even sure that we could. You know, I don't think we have the mental faculty to comprehend how amazing reality is. And it's that kind of perception that we should come at it from, because that will leave us more open to, you know, recognizing the truth when we see it. But, you know, one of the human fallacies is that you find what you're looking for. And if you're looking for the wrong thing, you'll find it. And if you're looking for the right thing, you'll find it. So, you know, I'll get into more about that. I think, you know, human nature is incredibly important. But I am running low on this video. And I'm just passing the 15-minute mark.